introduce my colleague, Susan Britt.
Thanks, Valerie. Hey, welcome everybody. I see so many returning names and lots of new names from all around the country. So we are thrilled to be providing this series of webinars around feline communication and handling, and we really hope they'll be useful for future staff and volunteer trainings via the recordings. Moderating the chat today are ASPCA staff members Dr. Emily Weiss and Heather Mohan-Gibbons. They'll be keeping an eye out for your questions. And we're also going to be presenting, providing links to some of the pretty nifty tools you're going to see today. So don't worry that you're going to have to capture all the information as you hear it. Our presenters today are Trish Lohr, Director of Applied Research and Behavior with the ASPCA's Shelter Research and Development Team, and Natasha Drain, Research Assistant also with the Shelter R&D Team. So Trish will be kicking us off today, so let me turn the microphone over to her.
Thank you, Susan. Welcome, everyone, to our fantastic webinar on cat handling and humane restraint. We're going to talk a little bit more about hands-on material this time around, so there will be information, whether you're new or very experienced, I think there will be something in here for everyone. Our goal is to teach you to handle cats gently but safely, and we want you to reduce the cat's stress levels and help avoid bites or scratches. So the arm, under the armpit hold is a perfectly safe way to pick up a child, and that's a way that a lot of people try to pick up cats. But we're just going to start by saying this is not comfortable or secure for cats and that it may even make them grumpy. So why are we here? This series is happening because shelter cats are statistically more likely to be euthanized than they are to be adopted. It's estimated that 7 out of 10 cats who come to a shelter will not find homes. So a lot of shelter cats aren't used to confinement. Some of them haven't met other animals or other strangers, and they easily become frustrated, shut down. They might redirect aggression when they're under stress. So we really want to teach everyone here how to handle cats safely, how to read feline body language, and allow more cats to get a chance on the adoption floor. So many of you have already seen our first webinar. It describes basic feline body language, and it's got some good tips on how to use your body language to show cats that you're no threat. We'll be sending you the link to this after the webinar if you missed it. It's a lot of fun. But today we're going to go over some techniques for picking up and handling cats, whether they're calm, wiggly, or upset cats. We're going to go over the concepts of minimal restraint and humane restraint. And we'll talk about some tools that we like and some tools that we don't like so much for handling cats. So if you've attended any of our communication webinars, you know how much we harp on keeping our language objective. If you are new to this, I'm just going to describe quickly. Objective language is unbiased, not influenced by your feelings. Think about your police inspector saying just the facts. That's really how you should talk about cat behavior. Subjective language, on the other hand, it's based on your own personal feelings. That's great if you're an author like Shakespeare, but it's not very useful when talking about behavior. So I'm going to give you a quick example. Think, you know, what is the cat doing rather than what do I think the cat is feeling? So think about if somebody warns you, oh, that cat's angry. Is that at all helpful to you if you're the next person to handle that cat? Probably not. But what if they said, this cat tries to bite if you scruff him? Now you actually have the tools to make sure that you don't get bitten and to keep that cat's stress level down. So I'm going to challenge you guys in the chat to watch for objective, good, clear language. And if you see people using great objective language, I want you to reinforce them. I want you to tell them, good job, in the chat. So we want to get you guys trained to talk like behaviorists. So we have a fun poll to start you guys off. Pick a number. Which one of these does not belong? If you are a cat handler in a shelter, which picture would you like to avoid? Just pop the number into the chat box. Excellent. We have. That is what I would like to avoid too. So before you begin, I'll let you guys keep typing numbers in, and I'll give you a couple of quick hints before you start working with a cat. Try to avoid having strong smells on yourself, perfumes, lotions, cigarettes, some hand sanitizers can upset cats. Also, if you're going to handle both cats and dogs in a day, make sure you handle the cats first rather than coming to the cats smelling like dogs. It can really upset cats, especially if they're not used to dogs. So a few other little hints. If you're just going to be picking up a calm cat, I like to start with a closed hand as a greeting. If you just hold your fist up to a cat, they will usually, if they're a socialized cat, they will reach forward, they will sniff it, and this gives them a chance, if they wish, to rub their nose or rub their cheeks against it or even bunch you with their foreheads, to that they have scent glands in their cheeks and they like to mark. So give them the chance to approach you first, and that can often make the interaction go better. When you're picking up the cat, remember to use one hand under the chest and one hand to support the back end. So remember our first picture, we want to avoid that. We want to always have two hands on the cat. Once you've got the cat in your arms, just cradle them gently. Don't squeeze them. Don't hug them too tightly. That can cause them to panic. So here are a few nice holds. If you've got a calm cat who's not struggling and who is used to being picked up, and throughout this presentation, if you're unfamiliar with cat handling, you might want to practice some of these poses, either with a stuffed animal or with a really calm cat, so that you can get comfortable with them before you have to handle a cat who's trying to escape from you. But these are all nice, gentle holds. You don't want to carry the cat through the shelter with any of these. They're not very secure, but they're comfortable for the cats. Here's a basic one-handed hold for cats. For example, if you're opening or closing the cage door with your other hand, you can support the cat with this, we call it the football hold. You can see that Jessie's arm is supporting the cat's weight. She's got her hand on the cat's chest. Again, this is for a calm, well-socialized cat. You can see he's still got the full use of his head. If he was likely to bite, he would be able to do that. But it's a nice hold for if you just have to hold them with one hand for a minute. If you need a little bit more control, this is the two-handed football hold. So you could put your second hand against the top of the cat's head or against the back of the cat's head. So if they started squirming, you would have a little more control of the head, and you would even be able to scruff the cat if they were really getting frantic. Here's a hold that I'm sure a lot of you use with your nice, calm cats at home. And again, if you're just socializing with a cat in a room and they feel like being held in this way, that's fine. This one is a caution, though. I definitely wouldn't want to carry a cat past other animals or something that might upset it, because you can see that this cat could use its teeth on Michelle's shoulder. He could use his paw, his front claws to claw her shoulder, and he could also launch off her belly with those hind legs. So this is okay for just a very, very calm cat in a room, but don't carry your cat through the shelter like this. Actually, don't carry your cat through the shelter at all. We like cats to be in carriers going through the shelter. So if you're going to work with cats who may scratch or bite, here are some holds that, again, you'll want to take a look at on your computer and practice on calm cats or stuffed animals. These take a little bit of skill. They take a little bit of practice, but they will work well for some cats. So number one is very similar to the football hold, you can see, but the second hand is under the cat's chin, and the fingers are grasping behind the jaw. This hold takes a lot of skill. If that hand slips, the cat can easily bite you. So this is a more advanced hold, but definitely one that you'd like, it's good to know. You could also choose to put your hand on top of the cat's neck, so that if they started struggling, you could scruff them if you're more comfortable with that. The hold in number two, the cat's legs are both folded underneath. You could also lock the cat's front legs. If you can see that the thumb is behind the cat's right arm, so this really immobilizes the front legs. So if this is a cat who likes to scratch, that's a safer hold. Here are a couple of variations of those two holds. There's the underhand hold from a different angle, and the overhand hold. So that's the football hold with the extra hand on the top of the cat's neck for a little more control. So some cats really don't want to leave their cage, and we love these beds with the sides on them. It makes the cat feel safe, but they can also be used as a little taco to pick the cat up. A lot of cats are more comfortable if the bed comes with them. It's got their scent on it. It's a safe place for them, and it also immobilizes their claws a little bit. It's quite a safe way to pick up cats. And you can see on the next slide that if you need to, once you get the cat out of the bed, out of the cage in his taco, you can use your second hand across the back of the cat's neck. So if he started squirming or trying to launch over her shoulder, Michelle could scruff the cat or take a little stronger hold. Now, a lot of people have trouble putting cats into crates, and here is the best secret for getting a cat into a crate. If you tip the crate on the end, it is so much easier to put the cat in. It's harder for him to put all four paws on the side of the crate and brace himself. And you can see that Jessie is holding both paws, or both sets of paws, between her fingers so that he can't put one leg on either side of the crate and launch back out. So this is a good one to send home with your adopters if they need to bring the cat to a vet.
I got it. Sure.
Okay. Oh, you're going to give us our video. Okay.
Yes.
So here is a video of how to put a less cooperative cat into a crate. And you can just start the video.
Sorry, it's loading. Give me 1 second. And all these videos will be recorded into the webinar recording.
Yeah, so you're going to see how to put a cat into a crate with using two people. One cool tip that you can use is you can hold the crate up off the floor so the cat doesn't have any purchase for their paws. And yes, having a partner helps.
And if you cannot see the videos or if you can't hear any of the audio, they will be in the recording. So sorry.
There's a few great holds for you for getting a cat into a carrier. And if they didn't play on the live webinar, they will play on your recording. So check them out when you get it tomorrow.
Oh, Trisha, I'm having a hard time hearing you.
Oh, okay. How's that?
There you are.
All right, there I am. So here's another little tip. If you've got a fearful cat in a cage and the cage is big enough to put a crate or a feral cat den in, rather than trying to wrangle the cat out of the cage and stuff them into the crate, which they may not like. Some cats, if they're really fearful of people, if you give them a place to hide, you bring the cat carrier or the feral cat den in, they will just run into the cage. So that's just another little tip for handling cats who may be fearful. So here are a few more good holds for more wiggly cats. You can see that this cat could use his teeth. So again, this is not for a cat who will bite, but if he's kind of wiggly and he wants to jump down, this is a way to control both the front and the back paws if you just need to get a cat from point A to point B. And this also this is how the paws are held when you're putting the cat into the crate as well. So there's some nice close-ups for you to practice these holds. Natasha's going to go into towels in a little more detail, but I'm just going to say that a really large, thick towel could help you control a lot of upset cats. What you do is tuck your hands on either side of the towel as you approach the cage so that the cat doesn't see the hands approaching. Cover the whole cat, remembering where the head is, so that you can control it. And once the towel is on the cat, you can if you need to, you can control the front legs by bringing one hand down on either side. Some cats don't like having their feet touch, so you figure out while you've got a hold of them if they're one of those cats. But as long as you have a good hold on the front legs, somebody else can access the cat if they needed to give injections. So towels are just awesome. I will let Natasha go into more detail on that. And with that, I'm going to hand it over to her for some more great tips and tools.
So hello, everyone. So today we're going to talk about humane handling and minimal restraint. Specifically with cats, you may have heard the phrase less is more, meaning you may receive more cooperation from a cat with less restraint. So we'll cover some minimal restraint techniques, which we hope shelters and veterinary clinics will run with. But we're also going to provide you with some humane handling tools that may assist in providing care for cats quickly and safely. So what is minimal restraint? Just briefly, the 2012 American Veterinary Medical Association describes minimal restraint as encompassing humane handling, and it is the idea that you should always use the least amount of restraint required to control an animal. It should minimize fear, pain, stress, and suffering for the animal, and should protect both animal and handler from harm. So, for those of you who were present during our feline communication webinar, compare the body language of both these cats. They're both being restrained in a veterinary environment, but notice the pupil size on the cat to the right. They're very dilated, and her whiskers are actually forward. She is being stretched out on her side and practically pinned to the exam table. We can't see the face of the cat in the photo to the left, but this cat appears to be quite relaxed in the handler's arms. We know that both these cats were very friendly, socialized cats, and both cats received the care that they needed. But who do you believe is receiving the best care in regards to welfare? So sometimes we resort to what we've always been taught to do with animals, and we should recognize the idea that this may not be necessary in every setting. If we're handling all calm cats, like the cat on the right, we could potentially be giving this cat a very negative experience and be setting the stage for a cat that's frightened or possibly fractious in the future. So in regards to cat handling, where do we begin? Some of us have never seen cats, never seen the handling of cats without scruffing. You may want to be aware that scruffing a cat immediately puts a cat on the defensive, whether they display a reaction or not. So let me paint an image for you. Imagine yourself being cooperative at a doctor's office, doing everything that's asked of you, and then suddenly they're placing a straitjacket on you just to perform a simple exam. How would you feel if that happened to you? So scruffing should really be the last resort. It's not a one-size-fits-all for every cat, and we can provide you with some techniques to get you started. We do want to stress, though, that these techniques will take practice, so continue to use the safe procedures you're currently using at your facility, but practice these methods with stuffed animals or well-socialized cats until you be comfortable implementing them. So, an alternative to scruffing would be the snake hold, aptly named after how snake holders hold snakes. As you can see from our photos, your forefinger and middle finger are on top of the cat's head, while your thumb and ring finger control the jaw below. This hold easily allows you to control the neck and head of the animal and can allow you the ability to slide off the cat's head and quickly scruff the cat if necessary without ever having to let go. If you're currently scruffing cats at your, every cat at your facility, this may be a nice, easy alternative for you. And if you're curious, the cat in the top left is a Devon Rex, and the orange boy is an ever-cooperative Sphinx cat named Disco Noferno, and he graciously volunteered to be our demo cat, so you'll see him throughout this presentation. So you heard Trish describe earlier how you might be able to hold a fearful or defensive cat with a towel to keep from getting scratched or bitten. But even the simple act of covering a cat's eyes can help to calm a cat. We'll mention towels a fair bit in regards to cat handling. So please use towels without holes or dangly threads. Towels that are large and dense enough to protect you from potential bites and scratches, but thin enough to where you can easily control the cat. Toweling an upset cat takes skill and solid nerves, so we recommend practicing with stuffed animals before trying this with a real cat. And possibly in every sort of setting, like inside cages, on exam tables, or maybe even on the floor, just to get comfortable in every possible scenario. So we're going to talk about some towel wrapping techniques. These are a few by Dr. Sophia Yin, who is a veterinarian, author, and lecturer with a specialty in animal behavior. These techniques we're about to show you are from her book called Low Stress Handling, Restraint, and Behavior Modification of Cats and Dogs. And we'll be providing you with Dr. Yin's resources at the end of the webinar. So we'll start with the scarf wrap that can be done by one person. This wrap gives access to the cat's head and can be used for medicating, giving shots, or a front leg blood draw. Before we play the video, go ahead and turn your volume up just to make sure that you hear the instructions. Valerie, are you taking over here?
Yes, I am.
Okay. Next is a towel wrapping technique of Dr. Yin's that can also be done by one person to give a cat an injection. So Dr. Sophia Yin has several more useful towel wrap techniques for cats, and you can get them from her resources, which we'll provide you at the end of the webinar. So we'll move on to some tools that can be used for humane handling. These tools are to be used at your comfort level. There's some people who would never use some of these items or would only use certain items depending on their level of skill. Not every tool works for every cat. Not every tool works for every handler. So this is just a basic list to provide you with some options to begin perfecting your own skill at cat handling. Some of these tools can be pricey, but we suggest that if that's the case, to go ahead and put the item on your wish list for your donors. Many of these are available at your usual animal control product websites, but we'll send you the links for some harder to find resources after the webinar. So we'll start with the least invasive tool and build from there. So Feel Away is a synthetic spray that mimics the cat's cheek pheromones and can have a calming effect on some cats. The spray comes in a diffuser or a spray form, and we think that the spray may be more effective in a shelter environment. Feel free to spray it on yourself, bedding, spray on a towel or a blanket before covering a cat's cage or carrier, spray it on toys, or whatever other ideas you may have. Custom Velcro collars. We like this product because it's one of the cheaper solutions we're presenting today. It's sturdy, easy on, easy off, and easily sterilized and reusable. You can see that this item is similar to an Elizabethan collar, but provides a little more in regards to its durability and easier to put on and take off because it uses the Velcro. Once it's sized, it'll fit most cats. And as Disco shows us in these photos, this collar allows you to handle the cat without the cat being able to turn its head to bite you. It also gives you a greater surface area to be able to manipulate the cat's head and provides you with a safe option when drawing blood, handling, medicating, and even carrying a cat. So you can see in the bottom right-hand corner that we've put on our creative thinking caps and turned the collar around. And this little trick keeps cats from reaching up and scratching someone that, for instance, may be trying to medicate them. So you may have seen this product used with dogs. The same principle applies here, where it's believed that cutting down visual stimulation may help to calm a cat. You're welcome to try this item on cats that might be fearful, tense, or unhappy, and see how well this product works for you. You may see this product marketed as a cat muzzle, but be aware that this does not protect you from being bitten. There's also a little hole at the end, and as you can see in the photo, the cats can fit their teeth through there. It is also only secured by the Velcro behind the cat's head, so a cat can easily remove it if it has access. We mentioned earlier that perhaps putting a towel over a cat's head can decrease visual stimulation. So this is an alternative to the calming cap. The cat muzzle or cat mask can protect you from being bit and also decreases visual stimulation. The mask fits directly onto the cat's face, its ears between the mask and the tie, and it must be securely tightened to make sure that it does not come off. It can take a fair amount of practice to become good at putting this on an unhappy cat, and typically the longer it takes you to put it on, the unhappier the cat. So it is effective once it's in place. The cat cannot bite you through the mask as it's made of heavy PVC plastic, but again, the cat can remove it if it's not securely tightened. There are several different types of gloves that can be used to handle cats. You'll find heavy-duty, almost welder-type gloves, like the ones on the left. These gloves are fairly thick and can protect you from bites, but I've personally seen cats that have still been able to bite through them. The gloves to the right are a bit thinner and provide you with more grasping ability, but you can absolutely be bit and scratched through those gloves. You'll hear a wide range of opinions on gloves in the cat handling world, and of the great cat handlers I've met, most don't like gloves alone for cat handling. They limit dexterity and they can provide a false sense of security to the handler. And it can also cause some cats to have a much more dramatic response than just using your hands. So we're not saying not to use gloves. Please use them to protect yourself, but be aware of their limitations. And like I said before, gloves can be very useful in conjunction with other tools. So still working through handling tools, we wanted to provide you with some touch-free options for those who may not be comfortable handling feral or fractious cats. These touch-free options may help save time and reduce the risk of injury to the cat and the handler. Feral cat dens are handy tools that can be used when working with fractious or unsocialized cats in a shelter. They're made of plastic with a plexiglass sliding front door that goes up and down, which can easily be removed, and a swinging circle-shaped plastic side window, which most cats can fit through. These dens can be useful when left inside a cage with only the circle door open, as most cats will climb into their dens when their cage is approached. So then all you would have to do is reach in, maybe with a simple back scratcher, and close the circle door. This would enable you to clean the cat's cage or transport the animal at your leisure. Some of these dens have a flat surface on the top, not the protruding plastic handles. And when these are kept in a cage, it provides a flat, elevated surface for the cat to rest on. And both hiding spots and elevated levels have been shown to aid in a cat's adjustment period to the shelter. Here are some photos of the cat dens happily in use. And I wanted to mention that even socialized cats appreciate having an elevated level and the choice to hide if they would like. So, the wild child. I'm a complete advocate of this product. Many veterinarians and shelter staff have never heard of the wild child, but it's one of the best tools I've ever used in regards to handling fractious cats. One second. I still want to show what's going on there, Valerie. If you'll just go back to the photo of the wild child. So it's a plexiglass box which provides a hands-free option when transferring, transporting, or providing injections to fractious or unsocialized cats. The lid can adjust to four different levels of restraint, and there are several holes on the sides and the top to be able to provide injections no matter what position the cat is in. So this video will just show you sort of how the wild child works. So you just saw several ways to get a cat from a carrier into a wild child, but you can do the same process only backwards to get a cat back into a carrier. You can get really creative with this product. I've used it to get uncooperative cats out of their cages and even to capture cats that have gotten loose. So from what I can tell, because the box is clear, cats don't seem to understand that something is going over their head, so you can use it in a variety of situations, and you never have to touch the cat. So the only drawback that I've found so far with this product is the price. But if you can save money on potential emergency visits for your staff who may be bit, it's worth its weight in gold. So the Easy Nabber is a mesh-type netting tool. I would suggest getting really comfortable with this tool before using it on cats, as you are literally squeezing the cat between two mesh nets, held together by your own muscle power. So if the cat struggles, you have to use more power to keep the nets closed. It's a bit invasive, and some cats will react to being inside of it. The nice thing about it, though, is that it easily fits inside most shelter-sized cages and may provide a quick tool to grab a cat. I've seen this tool used to provide injections or clean wounds or to quickly move a cat into another cage nearby. The Plexi Shield can be a handy tool to block a cat or to hold a cat in place inside its cage. We wanted to show you that you can use this tool easily to clean around a cat who may strike out, like shown in our photo. It is typically used with steel cages. The shield is the exact size of the cage so that the cat has no escape. You then press the cat between the shield and the wall of the cage to be able to provide an injection through the holes in the plexiglass. This is very invasive and upsetting to the cat and requires a pretty confident handler. I've seen two types of plexi shields, one with a diagonal handle like the one in the photo, and one with a small handle directly in the middle. I feel I have more comfortable with the small handle, but if you choose to use this product, you can figure out what works for you.
Hey, Natasha.
Yes.
It's Susan, and I'm wondering, before we go on, we've got a lingering question about the wild child.
Okay.
Carol Ann is wondering, how would you get a cat out of a live trap into that?
That is kind of tricky. I haven't had much success with getting a cat out of a trap into a wild child. You may have to have some sort of transition cage. You know, if you can fit the cat into a feral den, maybe you can put the cat from the feral den into the wild child. So that gets tricky. So we'll just have to invent something that would
Great.
Be useful to do
Great.
That. Okay, so next is chemical restraint. Chemical restraint is the act of sedating or tranquilizing the animal in order to complete a necessary procedure. Sometimes this is the most humane option for some cats that are too stressed when they're handled. We showed you earlier that the wild child can be used to give an injection, and this also encompasses chemical restraint. And we have another video for you to show you a feral cat in a trap who is going to be sedated for spay-neuter. So nets are what we're going to talk about next. Nets can be great tools for capturing loose cats who you cannot handle, yet it's most effectively used with an experienced netter who knows what they're doing and remains calm. We recommend using nets with very fine mesh, specifically the Versa net, because cats' legs and nails can easily become tangled or snag in nets with large mesh. Please do not chase cats, as it only escalates the situation and increases the stress on the cat and you. And if you're in a cat room, it can also stress other cats as well. So the best way is to remain focused and stay calm. Dr. Yin has great tips on learning to use a net, so you'll watch the video here. So again, we just recommend practicing all of these neat techniques with a stuffed animal before doing it on real animals. So the zip net is another type of net we recommend. It's made of fine mesh, has an adjustable opening at the top and a zipper at the bottom for easy removal of an animal. This is a great video on cat handling that we want to show you. Cat experts Bruce Ernest and Colleen Porth are using the Buddy system, which we mentioned earlier. In this video, a possibly feral cat was captured and then collared by staff while it was anesthetized. The cat gained weight during its stay at this facility, so the collar needed to be removed. You can go ahead and play. So this could have been a really long and stressful process, but it was accomplished in only a few minutes without having to anesthetize the cat. And now Trish will talk to you about what tools need to be used with extreme caution.
Hi, thanks, Natasha. So I'm going to rant a little bit about tools that go around cats' necks. Anything that you put around a cat's neck can be really dangerous. Cats have a lot of body strength. They tend to panic when their airway is constricted, and a cat that's being restrained tightly by the neck can seriously injure or even kill themselves. So these are with extreme caution. So these photos are also from Dr. Yin's book, and she shows the only safe way to use a snappy snare. I would not use it for a cat who's just standing on a table. This would be something that could be used to get a cat out from under somewhere. Some handlers are told to put a front leg through the snare if possible. That's often easier said than done. But you can see as soon as the cat is captured by the snare, Dr. Yin's assistant is immediately covering the cat with a towel so the cat is not flipping around on the end of the snare. So this is in the if nothing else will work, if you can't get a net in there. This is used with extreme caution and get the cat covered or into a net as quickly as you can. The cat tongs are another use with caution tool. And again, this would be something that you would only use very briefly if a cat was stuck behind a bank of cages and you couldn't get them out in any other way. You would, again, want to immediately cover the cat or restrain them in some other way. You're not going to leave a cat flipping around. A catch pole, which is sometimes called a rabies pole, this is a tool that is made for dogs. This is a tool that I would love, love, love for nobody ever, ever to use on a cat again. These are, the wire can tighten really quickly when you pull on it, and it can seriously injure a cat if they are flipping around on the end of it. They can hurt themselves. So there is always a better way. Do not use catch poles on cats. So a few final tips for you. Try using the easiest way first. Try using the minimal restraint, and you may find that cats are a lot more cooperative than you think they're going to be. The tools that we've mentioned throughout are things that you need to have close at hand in your cat wards. At a minimum, you would want to have towels, nets, gloves, a feral cat den perhaps. So have the tools ready to use when you need them. I can't say enough great things about the buddy system. If you have an extra set of hands when you're handling a difficult cat, that can make all the difference. And of course, try to remain calm. It's not always easy, but breathe, and that will help the cats remain calm as well. So I would like to thank you very much for attending our cat handling webinar. And as we say goodbye, I would love to hear what you've learned from this webinar. If you could type into the chat box what new tool or technique you're going to consider trying, I would very much appreciate it. And we have many, many, many people to thank for helping with this webinar. I can't thank Dr. Yin enough for allowing us to use her pictures and videos from her book. The Champagne Humane Society gave us cats and handlers to be models. The Cat Hospital of Fairfax, again, provided Disco Noferno and other fantastic cats and models, and the Wild Child. Meg Allison did some great photographs. We've got Suzanne DeLonzo, Jesse Winters, Katie Watts, Jesse Oldham, Barbara McDonald, and Dr. Kat Miller all took a look at this and gave us great input. So thank you very much. I had one lingering question from before. There was a question about the calming cat. The picture that we showed is an item called a cat muzzle. It is similar to Trish King's calming cat, which I believe Premier carries, but it is not actually a muzzle. It works more as something to reduce the cat's visual stimulation. But we will send you links to get all of the great resources that we've mentioned. And thank you so much for coming to our webinar, and I hope this helps you handle cats safely.
Yeah, thanks, Trish and Natasha. Holy smokes, it takes a village and a village really did put together this webinar. We have a question, a real simple question from registration. What are the hallmarks of a good buddy system? How do you help people start to work together in pairs?
You want to take that one, Natasha? Are you still muted?
I was still muted. I'm sorry. So the first thing is find somebody that you worked with before, someone that you feel comfortable and that you trust. I think communication is really key. You know, what direction are you going? Where's the head? Do you have a hold on this? You know, even scruffing a cat, you know, if you're going to lose your hold, you let your partner know. So it's really just communication that's the key.
Fantastic. We've got a question in chat from Paula asking, do you think calming caps might prevent help motion sickness for transport?
You know, I've never used that for transport. I might try covering the carrier with a towel first. Maybe that would work better. I mean, the cats can just pull the caps off of their head if they choose to, but you're welcome to try. Just be aware that if the cats do vomit or anything, that it will catch in that calming cap.
Mm. So believe it or not, I think we have answered all the questions that came in
at
registration. And unless I'm missing something huge in chat, I think we've covered most of the questions that came in via chat. And sounds like lots of people are going to be shopping and practicing with new tools. So thanks so much, everybody. We'll see you next time.
Thank you.
Thank you.